As all of you are aware, that both in the Raj Sabha and in the Lok Sabha, the Indian National Congress had raised the issue of electoral bonds. Even yesterday, our leader of opposition in the Raj Sabha, our deputy leader in the Raj Sabha, and our floor leader in the Lok Sabha, and the chairperson of our communications department, they had briefed you extenso about the electoral bonds. So therefore, it is not my intent to go into the facts, for the facts are now extremely well known, documented. They are in the public space. News websites have done seminal work in bringing the facts into the public domain. What we would like to focus on today is the reason why electoral bonds and their completely opaque nature is a fundamental threat to democracy as it stands constituted. See, democracy is a function of public trust. And the 900 million, 950 million Indians who elect their representatives and send them to the House of the People and send representatives to the various state assemblies, they expect that their representatives would raise issues of public interest and in a sense do their bidding. However, when democracy becomes hostage to the influence of big money, you are skidding down a slippery slope. And it's not very evident as to when that skid is really going to stop. The framers of the Indian Constitution and the successive governments which followed from 1952 onwards had put in place a very robust architecture, a very robust legal architecture to insulate our political processes from the pernicious influence of big money. Because they had seen as to how big money had played an extremely deleterious role in democracies around the world. All of you would recall that at the turn of the 20th century, which was the Rockefeller era in the politics of the United States of America, how that was called the Gilded Age of American politics, and the role which money was playing in choices which elected representatives were making. And finally, the United States had to enact the antitrust laws in order to break large corporations, to bring this money power to a head. And that's why successive governments had made sure that our electoral finance system or our political financing system should be kept as free from the influence of big corporate money as possible. So you had provisions in the Income Tax Act, in the Companies Act, in the Income Tax Act, in the Foreign Exchange Management Act, and various other laws which sought to insulate and isolate this influence of money. In 2017, in the guise of the finance bill, without a structured discussion in Parliament or in the public space on electoral campaign financing or political financing, the NDA-BJP government smuggled these anonymous, opaque electoral bonds into our political system. They, with one stroke, dismantled that entire architecture, amended the Representation of People's Act, whereby they ensured that these anonymous donations do not have to be divulged even to the Election Commission as a part of the tax returns which political parties file. They amended the Companies Act, took away the 7.5% cap on average net profits over 3 years, which was the maximum amount which could be donated. They amended the Income Tax Act, whereby putting in place an architecture that these anonymous donations need not be even disclosed to the income tax authorities. The Reserve Bank of India Act was amended. The Foreign Exchange Management Act was amended. And this happened despite strident opposition of both the Election Commission and the Reserve Bank of India. The Reserve Bank of India went so far as to say that this will undermine the Indian currency. The Election Commission had some very valid objections which they put on record, which were not dealt with. And even Parliament was misled by the then minister with regard to the objections of the Election Commission. And finally, what transpired is that from available data, which is the 2017-18 tax returns of the Bharatiya Janata Party, for which data is publicly available, 95% of the money which came in through electoral bonds in the first tranche went to the Bharatiya Janata Party. Now, this is a part of their tax returns. Now, this raises obvious questions. Was there a quid pro quo in these donations? Was influence over policy and legislation sought to be exercised? And the fact is that these so-called anonymous donations are really not even anonymous, because the State Bank of India is but an extension of the Government of India. And the State Bank of India has a seamless tracking system whereby the identity of the bond buyer to the identity of the recipient is tracked by the State Bank of India for the ostensible purposes of reconciliation. But it provides a seamless paper trail of who the buyer is and who the recipient is. And the only people who are privy to this information is the Government of India. And so therefore, this creates a completely unlevel playing field. Given the kind of political vendetta that this government has done a PhD in, somebody would have to be stark raving mad to make a donation to an opposition party, knowing fully well what the consequences of that donation could be. So there are extremely serious issues which undermine the very essence of Indian democracy as it stands constituted. You know, we've talked at at great length about electronic voting machines, and my argument with regard to the electoral bonds is the same argument which I have made to you earlier with regard to electoral voting machines. The question is that, the question is not that a system can be rigged. The question is that there's a perception that the system can be rigged. And that undermines the faith of people in democracy. And here, there is empirical evidence almost available that the system is being gamed to the advantage of people in government. And that is evidenced that if 95% of the electoral bonds in the first tranche flow in a particular direction, it does not require rocket science to actually figure out as to what is happening. So therefore, that is why we demanded in the lower house, where I was unfortunately abruptly cut off, and in the upper house, where I hope my colleagues had better luck, that there should be a full-fledged discussion on the entire gamut of electoral financing and the financing of our political system with these anonymous electoral bearer bonds being an intrinsic part of that discussion. We are fully cognizant of the fact that the matter is sub judice, and the Supreme Court had given interim directions with regard to political parties having to disclose by the 30th of May 2019 the quantum of electoral bearer bonds that they have received. The Congress, the Indian National Congress, contrary to certain reports which had appeared in certain sections of the media yesterday, has actually complied with that deadline. The same possibly cannot be said about the Bharatiya Janata Party. So, on one hand, while Parliament is the appropriate forum to discuss the damage which these bonds are doing to our democracy, we would also like to urge the Supreme Court to expeditiously hear this matter and render a final judgment. And since the Election Commission is bound by the interim orders of the Supreme Court, we obviously cannot and should not and will not ask the Election Commission to divulge the details of the donors and the donees. But I think it's an issue which goes to the very heart of our electoral system as it stands constituted. Then, of course, there is the attendant issue that this particular electoral bearer bond scheme was supposed to be limited to the elections of the House of the People. And this was evidenced by note sheets of the government which are now in the public space, that even the Secretary of the Department of Economic Affairs shared that particular point of view as on 4th of April 2018. And suddenly, after a minute records that PMO desired that a window should be opened for the Vidhan Sabha elections of Karnataka, the secretary and the ministry in question does a complete U-turn. The philosophy of the bureaucracy in this government seems to be, when asked to jump, they don't ask how high. They don't ask why, they ask how high. So, we are living in absolutely the strangest of times to speak of. And therefore, it is imperative that this entire scheme of electoral bearer bonds, which is going to have very, very far-reaching implications on the health of our democracy, need to be revisited, need to be discussed in detail. Maybe it needs to be scrapped. But at least it needs to be amended so that there is a more robust architecture and a level playing field in place. So that's the real philosophy as to why the electoral bearer bonds are an issue which we've raised and which we will continue to raise during the rest of this session to the best of our ability. If you want, I'll do a short repeat in Hindi, otherwise I'll leave it at this. Because essentially whatever I had to say, I already said in the house in Hindi, but if you want it, I'll repeat it, otherwise we'll leave it. Aaj Lok Sabha mein aur Raj Sabha mein भारतीय राष्ट्रीय कांग्रेस ने ये जो अज्ञात चुनावी बॉन्ड हैं इनका मुद्दा उठाया। हम उन तथ्यों में नहीं जाना चाहते जो तथ्य सारे सार्वजनिक हैं। इस मुद्दे को उठाने का मूल उद्देश्य हमारा ये था कि इन अज्ञात चुनावी बॉन्ड्स का भारत के लोकतंत्र के ऊपर बहुत ही नकारात्मक और बहुत ही दूरगामी प्रभाव पड़ने वाला है और उसका कारण यह है कि जब से भारत के संविधान की संरचना हुई उसके बाद हर सरकार ने यह कोशिश की कि जो पूंजीपति हैं धन पशु हैं जिनके पास बड़ा सरमाया है उस सरमाए का असर भारत की सियासत पे कम से कम पड़े कि भारत का शासन और प्रशासन जो आम जनता की आशाएं और आकांक्षाएं हैं उसके अनुरूप चले ना कि सूट बूट वालों के इशारे पे और इसीलिए चाहे इनकम टैक्स एक्ट हो चाहे रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ पीपल्स एक्ट हो चाहे कंपनीज एक्ट हो चाहे फॉरेन एक्सचेंज मैनेजमेंट एक्ट हो इन सब में ये प्रावधान किया गया था एक दीवार खड़ी की गई थी ये जो बड़े सरमाएदारों का पैसा है इसका प्रभाव भारत की राजनीति पे कम से कम रहे। 2017 में 2017 के आम बजट में इस ढांचे को एनडीए भाजपा सरकार ने पूरी तरह से ध्वस्त कर दिया। सारे कानूनों में फाइनेंस बिल के माध्यम से संशोधन कर दिया और फाइनेंस बिल में लाने का कारण यह था क्योंकि इनको मालूम था कि अगर अलग से लाते तो राज्यसभा में यह पारित नहीं हो सकता था और इस तरह की प्रक्रिया के ऊपर जिस तरह की टिप्पणी उच्चतम न्यायालय से आई है वो सब आपके सामने है। तो कुल मिलाकर जो मुद्दा है वो ये है कि कोई भी लोकतंत्र लोगों के भरोसे पे चलता है और इलेक्ट्रॉनिक वोटिंग मशीन के संबंध में भी हमने वही तर्क दिया था कि मामला ये नहीं है कि इलेक्ट्रॉनिक वोटिंग मशीन से छेड़छाड़ की जा सकती है। बुनियादी बात यह है कि लोगों के मन में यह धारणा है कि इससे खिलवाड़ किया जा सकता है इससे छेड़छाड़ की जा सकती है इट कैन बी गेम्ड। और जब लोकतंत्र में किसी प्रक्रिया के ऊपर लोगों का विश्वास उठना शुरू हो जाए तो ये लोकतंत्र के लिए बहुत घातक है। और जो इलेक्टोरल बेरर बॉन्ड्स का अनुभव रहा है अभी तक, 95% पैसे भारतीय जनता पार्टी को जा रहे हैं, तो ये सवाल खड़ा होता है कि क्या इसमें कोई क्विड प्रो को है, इसमें कहीं पे किसी ने किसी नीति को किसी पॉलिसी को प्रभावित तो नहीं किया। और 6100 करोड़ से ज्यादा के बॉन्ड्स जब से ये स्कीम शुरू हुई है तब से खरीदे बेचे गए, तो इसलिए ये हमने मुनासिब समझा, अपना इतनी जिम्मेवारी समझी कि इसके ऊपर एक विस्तृत चर्चा लोकसभा और राज्यसभा में हम मांगे। और सदन जितने भी दिन और चलेगा, हमारी ये कोशिश होगी कि जितनी क्षमता हम में है बाकी विपक्षी दलों को भी साथ लेते हुए हम इस मुद्दे को निरंतर और लगातार उठाते रहें। और उच्चतम न्यायालय से भी हमारी ये मांग है, क्योंकि मामला उच्चतम न्यायालय में लंबित है, कि उच्चतम न्यायालय भी जल्द ये इलेक्टोरल बेरर बॉन्ड्स के ऊपर फैसला करे। उन्होंने एक अंतरिम ऑर्डर दिया है, उस अंतरिम ऑर्डर की पालना करना सबका कर्तव्य बनता है और उसके अनुसार राजनीतिक दलों को 30 मई 2019 तक जितने बेरर बॉन्ड्स उनके पास आए थे उसका खुलासा, उसका वेरवा चुनाव आयोग को देना था। कांग्रेस पार्टी ने वो वेरवा दे दिया है। कई बाकी पार्टियों के बारे में, खासकर सत्तारूढ़ दल के बारे में ये बात नहीं कही जा सकती। तो ये एक बहुत ही संवेदनशील मामला है और इसकी नजाकत को जहन में रखते हुए ये जो लोकतंत्र का मंदिर है जहां पे हम बैठे हैं, इसकी रक्षा और सुरक्षा करने के लिए और आम आदमी की जो आस्था है भारत की लोकतंत्र में उसको बचाने के लिए ये इलेक्टोरल बेरर बॉन्ड्स और इसके माध्यम से इलेक्टोरल कैंपेन फाइनेंस और पॉलिटिकल फाइनेंसिंग पे एक विस्तृत चर्चा की दोनों सदनों में जरूरत है। थैंक्स। Well, the government has every reason to ignore our demand, because if 95% of the money is flowing one way, you know, obviously they have a lot to answer for. But that's not the question. The question is that today you are confronted with a fundamental threat to our democratic system. In 2017, when this bond scheme was issued, and the then finance minister, Mr. Arun Jaitley, may his soul rest in peace, had waxed eloquent in various blogs and public statements that this would cleanse up the political system, the experience of the past 2 years has been very much to the contrary. So therefore, not only is there a difficulty with the electoral bearer bond scheme as it stands constituted, but equally difficult are the transgressions which have taken place. And unfortunately, the transgressions seem to be a command performance on the instructions of the Prime Minister's office. You know, one could very well ask a question that how does it really concern the Prime Minister's office to be directing the Finance Ministry to open a window before the Karnataka elections, when there was an explicit rejection earlier by the Department of Economic Affairs of a similar effort 2 weeks, a week earlier, and then you see a complete somersault. So there are disturbing issues, you know, which have come to light, and you know, this has all, and then of course There are objections of the Reserve Bank of India in the case of demonetization. You saw how the Reserve Bank of India was overruled. There are issues with regard to the fact that Parliament was misled and subsequently an attempt was made to cover up. So there are hugely, hugely problematic issues which have emerged out of whatever documentation is available in the public space. So therefore, ideally there should be a joint parliamentary committee which should go into it. But in the first instance, there at least should be a discussion in both houses of parliament. You just cannot drive it under the carpet.
My question was on technical aspect, that the government
allow for. See, unfortunately, there's a flawed understanding of what the word sub judice means. Sub judice is a concept which was relevant when you had a jury system. So when you had a jury system, the reason why matters which were under consideration of a jury were not supposed to be discussed in the public domain was because it should not influence the minds of the jurors. As we've moved away from the jury system, frankly, this whole concept of sub judice is redundant. This has become a fig leaf to drive discussions under the carpet. And if you want an endorsement of my views from the other side, you can go and talk to Dr. Subramanian Swamy. We are asking for three things. Number one, we are asking for a full-fledged discussion on electoral financing, political financing, with electoral bearer bonds being an integral part of that discussion in both houses of parliament. Two, we are specifically asking for a joint parliamentary committee to look into the entire scheme of electoral bearer bonds. And number three, we are requesting the Supreme Court to take a final view on the very legality of these electoral bearer bonds, given the fact that the Reserve Bank of India is on record saying that it is a threat to our monetary system. The Election Commission is on record in the Supreme Court saying that, well, in a sense, that is what they have said, that this has serious implications for Indian democracy. One by one, yeah? Well, I do not want to get deflected onto a discussion on electronic voting machines at this point in time. That was an aside to buttress the point. But suffice to say, we've said this repeatedly ad nauseum again and again, that we should move back to paper ballots. And be that as it may, insofar as what our agitational strategy would be, or you know, how would we take this issue to the people, I think you'll have to wait for a proper briefing from some of our colleagues once we've finalized our strategy. Yes.
Why is it that the opposition
party, other opposition parties, are not getting this issue? This is affecting them as well as it's you. So, will they be effort from your side to raise more votes? Raise the issue? Well, let me dispel a fallacy that we are raising this issue because we are not getting the money. I want to dispel that straight off the bat. The reason why we are raising this issue is because we feel that it is a fundamental threat to democracy. And I do hope the other opposition parties also see it that way. And we obviously would try and walk the extra mile to get them on board. Yeah, there was a question there. Yeah. Okay. No, we'll reach out to all. Rather, we'll reach out to all political parties, because this is not something which concerns just a political party or the opposition. I think the concern is larger. So, leaving the BJP aside, which obviously has everything to gain by not allowing this matter to be discussed, we definitely do think that this is something which merits the or warrants the consideration of every political party. Well, when I say every political party, I mean every political party. We are not taking any questions other than electoral bonds today. So therefore, I think this is an extremely important issue. Whatever other questions that you'll have to leave it for another day. Thank you.